Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Can everybody hear me? Are you Mike? No talking. Some of you might remember, my name is Bob Healy. I am the vice chairman of this committee, the Hall of Fame. And we are very happy to see such a wonderful turnout for our very first inaugural induction tonight. Long overdue. Leominster being the kind of sports town that it is. We'd like to start the evening. Would everybody please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, God, indivisible, liberty, and justice for all. If you remain standing, please, and we'd like to have a moment of silence for those athletes and teachers and people that helped us throughout the years have passed away. A couple are being inducted tonight. We'll have a moment of silence for them, please. Thank you. Now, I'm so glad to see we all found a seat. Would table four please switch to table five? I think they're in the wrong seat. Thank you for your patience at the beginning of trying to switch over from the wedding to this event tonight. But we got everybody in and everybody's seated, which is great. First person that we are going to call on is Frank Stefanides, who is the chairman of our Hall of Fame committee, and he'll explain to you a little bit about the committee and what we endeavored to do.
Tell you, getting ready for this is like getting ready for a big game. You guys that have played ball, you know, getting ready for a big game, all of a sudden someone changes the game plan on you. You got to adjust, and we did. You did a great job getting settled into your seats, and you were very, very, very nice about it. Thank you. I appreciate that. That was my job to the seats. Okay? This committee and this Hall of Fame has taken 2 years to come about. We started about 2 years ago. Getting together as a group, and initially I sat down with the AD, the principal, and with the school committee to present what we're going to do, and they were all very supportive of what we're doing today. As we went through this, the baseball had their own Hall of Fame, and with Rich Barnaby has joined us. He's now one of our officers, and at this point, what I'd like to do is introduce our board of directors, our board of committee, so we can all see who they were. So, first of all, you met Bob, you know me. Shelly Barry, right here, the secretary. Rich Barnaby, treasurer. Tom Ciccolini, that did everything. Carl Baker, one of the inductees. Gil Tremblay. Emil Johnson in the back of the stage. New AD, Lorraine Cipolla. Also on the committee, we're not here tonight, were Lynn Denning Keenan. Her son's playing college ball down in New Jersey someplace, so she's down there. And Pete Michaels, out of state. As we proceeded through the process of getting this organized, legalities of it, and a lot of stuff we had to do in the backside of this to make it work, we did continue to build on that. Now we have a solid background to go through. We have a website, it's Leominster Athletic Hall of Fame, -hallofffame.com, and all information's on there for you to look at. Pictures from here will be on there. And some other stuff that Bob is gonna talk to you about will be there also. Lynn Keenan has run that very well, and it's a really good website. It's growing daily. It started small, it's building up this big website now, and you get a lot of stuff out of it. And like I said, there'll be nomination forms on there for you to fill out if you want to nominate someone in the future. What we did this year is we took state championship teams. The three teams here are all state champs. And we took 14 individuals in the same round. As we get down the road, the nomination process will open up. So people have said, well, so-and-so belongs here too. I said, yeah, it'll be nomination process soon. And you can get those forms online eventually. And if you want someone, you can fill out the form, send it in. We'll have a committee screen them, and we'll go from there. On the website, though, we have sponsorship and donation forms. That's big. As we go through this, we need support. We have a golf tournament during the, we just had it a couple of weeks ago. We have a trivia night. We do it here during the winter. And we do donations to the program, and people have also donated to our website. So whatever donation we can get to support this event and keep it running, we appreciate that. And they're online too, okay? I'd like to, first of all, congratulate the current inductees, all three teams and all 14 individuals. There are a couple that aren't here tonight, but I know one has passed away. We'll get to that in a minute. So at this point, I'd like to turn the mic back over to Bob and continue on. Thank you.
Thank you, Frank. Our first presenter of Bob Kusumboom will be Dom Ciccolini.
Thank you. Bob Kusumboom. Not many young people know who he is. But he tasked your grandparents, your parents. He was the man in Lemesis, Bob Kusumboom. Bob was born in Lemesis, spent his whole life here. Went to Lemesis High School, graduated in 1945, president of his class. If you look at his little bio in his yearbook, it says he wanted to be a sports reporter. Well, that never happened. He never left town, became a shoe salesman. But he was no ordinary shoe salesman. Bob Kusumboom, in World War II, there was something called TAC. I know Gil's gonna say it was Teenage Canteen, someone says it was Teenage Center, but it was an organization for teens. And then it sort of died out, and in 1947, that's what I heard, 48, now some people say it's 50, rose up again, and it was called Teenage Gathering or Teenage Group. And that's when Bob Kusumboom came about. He became its director. And he took it to a whole nother level. Bob decided that whatever they did in that group, any money they made was going to go to the teens of Leominster. And everyone knows about the tag dances. If you were from Leominster or 20 miles around, that's where you had to be on Saturday night. Well, you wanted to be on Saturday night. I was a Catholic boy, I didn't get to go. St. Leo's kind of thing. My parents thought all kinds of bad things went on down there. But what he did do, he started, they sponsored baseball teams, basketball teams. They bought uniforms for cheerleaders. Any kid he found out that was struggling or their parents, they took care of them. It was really something. They had offices. Matter of fact, two of the inductees, at least tonight, were presidents of TAG. And all came about by the guy who was a shoe salesman, Bob Kusumboom. A whole generation of teens in Lemesis owe a lot to him. And he never got his dream, but I think the smiles on kids' faces and what he was able to do for them really made him happy. Sadly, he passed away in 2012, 85 years of age. And it's my pleasure, it's my honor, it's our honor to induct Bob Kusumboom into the Lemesis High School Athletic Hall of Fame. Please give him a round of applause. And accepting for Bob is his good friend, Bob Johnson.
Bob was a... Bob was a really special person, and tonight, if I had a chance to speak, I was going to mention him anyway. He was as kind a person as you could find. He saw... He could never be upset or angry with anyone. He was someone that I would always want to go to and see if there was a problem, and he would just talk it over. But out of all the people that I've met in my life, and I was a teacher for 34 years, the nicest one was Bob Crosby.
Our next presenter is Mr. Emil Johnson, who will make his presentation to Mike Marshing.
Mike Marchand played for Lemester High School baseball the first year I became the head coach. Mike was a hard-throwing right-hander who kept the ball below the waist. Very, very difficult. He threw a heavy ball. His record as a senior was 9-0 during the regular season. His earned run average was 0.76. And if baseball fans know, that's something special. The team, we had a good team, was 17-0 in the regular season. We went undefeated in the regular season play. Come the district playoffs, we won the quarterfinal and the semifinal, won it 19 in a row. We were to play Shrewsbury at WPI in the district championship game. We were leading that game 1-0 in the ninth inning. They had two men on and two outs. One was a first man got on first base, and to this day, the worst call in 43 years of coaching baseball. The man was out by a step and a half at first base, on the third up. He unfortunately walked the next man, a man named Orisi, come up, the number three hitter, hit a pop-up behind the plate. John Cully, who was our catcher, spun around to get the pop-up and tripped over the umpire's foot. Fell to the ground, got up, dove for the ball hit his glove, and fell out. Well, needless to say, you know what happened on the next pitch. The boy got a full scholarship to Stanford, not for what he did, because he was a great player, a catcher. He hit a shot in the right center field. He scored the two runs, and we went home failing to win the districts by a score of 2-1, ending up at 19-1. On the season, Mike pitched 88 2/3 innings and had 104 strikeouts. He was a fierce competitor, but when he was on the mound, he was a tiger. I'd like to present to the Hall of Fame Mike Mashin. First of all, I'd like to thank the committee.
I know that they work long and hard to find all these people that are going to receive these awards this evening. It closes the book in my yearbook, my chapter of baseball. It makes me very, very proud, and my family very proud. I will honor this and cherish this forever. It wasn't too hard to become the very best, and what we did, having the greatest coach. He not only taught us how to play baseball, he taught us about life. Taught us how to win, taught us how to lose, and he taught us everything that was going on in this world. In 1972, I stopped playing baseball because my dad had taken ill. And at that time, I was on the East Coast League playing for the Braves out of Acton. I played 3 years for them up and down the East Coast. And while I was there, I met a wonderful lady. A lady that became my best friend and my wife. She didn't know the difference at the time between a baseball and a basketball. And she learned real fast. She would jump in that car at 4 o'clock and meet us wherever we had to go. Because in those days, you played baseball because you wanted to play baseball. And you were doubleheaded Saturday, Sunday, and everything else. Then along in our lives came our two wonderful children. Two kids that couldn't have made us more proud than anybody in this whole wide world. And I sincerely am so honored to have them as our two children. You know, ladies and gentlemen, never been to heaven, but it can't be any better than this. Thank you.
One thing I forgot to mention at the very beginning was we hope that because of the number we have that everybody will remain for all of the inductions that we have as a tribute and out of respect for those that are toward the end of the list. Also, if you want pictures, there are going to be pictures available on Rick Marchand Blue Devil Photo on Facebook. And they're free. That's the best part. You get what you like. Okay. We'll also have that listed on our website. Next, I'd like to call up Mr. Gil Trumbly, who will introduce to you Danielle Lund McNamara.
When you're the oldest member of the committee, you tend to move more slowly. My apologies for that. I have the honor of presenting a young lady whom I have not met. Unfortunately, I did not have her as a student when I was teaching. She graduated 3 years after I had retired, but I've heard all about her. In fact, when she was a freshman, I remember people saying, "Have you seen this girl play tennis? She is a prospect. She's going to do a lot more than just play at Leominster High." Well, here's the resume. Let me pick out the high points. First of all, as I said, she graduated in 1996, earned bachelor's degrees in economics and organizational studies at Michigan in 2001, helped lead Michigan to its first Big Ten championship, not in football, in tennis. We know Michigan Big Ten football, but tennis. She was selected Big Ten Conference Sportswoman of the Year in 1999. She went on to do some assistant coaching, competed on the World Tennis Association Tour for 4 years. She was named Yale University's head coach in 2007. She led the Bulldogs to their first Ivy League title since 89 with a perfect 7-0 mark. And in 2015, she was named head coach at University of Texas. So it is a pleasure to present to you Danielle Lund McNamara.
And to be able to be here and celebrate this very special evening. I'd like to congratulate all of my fellow inductees on your amazing accomplishments and your careers. And before I say a few thank yous to my family, I just want to thank the Hall of Fame committee for all of the time and effort and energy that they put into not just making this evening possible, but the last 2 years going through the selections and fundraising and planning, executing, organizing, all of the behind the scenes that has made this night possible. We are very, very grateful for everything that you've done. In putting my thoughts together for this evening and reflecting on my time at Leominster High School, I kept coming back to two things that I remember vividly. A lot of school and a lot of tennis. And a lot more school and a lot more tennis. And I would say that really the term that would just define my 4 years is student athlete. I may not have had the most typical high school experience, but I definitely am incredibly grateful for the experience that I did have. For me, this Hall of Fame honor is not about any one particular match or conference title or trophy or accolade or record or any of that. For me, this recognition tonight really encompasses my entire experience as a high school student athlete at Leominster High. And whenever we experience success in any capacity in life, I feel like that success is a result of many different hands at work, some seen and some unseen, that have worked together to make that success a reality. Excuse me. In my time at Leominster High School, I was impacted and influenced by so many wonderful leaders and role models that have helped shape me to be the person and the tennis player that I am today. I had outstanding teachers in the classroom that gave me the knowledge and the tools to go on to the University of Michigan and to have continued success. I had great friends that supported my goals as a student athlete. Actually, one of them is my fellow classmate that I've been friends with since fourth grade, and another inductee this evening, Amanda Kerouac. I had a wonderful tennis coach, high school tennis coach in Sam Massetti, who I'm so sorry is not here this evening. But he was an outstanding coach and an even better person that taught me so much about life. I had a junior tennis coach named Mike Gardner who taught me so much more than forehands and backhands. He taught me life lessons that I too carry with me to this day. But most certainly, when I look back on my high school years in particular, the two cornerstones of my life have always been my parents. They're hidden behind the speaker here with me tonight. They still live in Leominster, and it's hard to put into words all the things that I've learned from my parents. I have been so lucky to have such great role models and teachers in them. They've showed me unconditional love and support while still pushing me and challenging me to be the best person that I can be. They taught me what hard work is. They taught me what discipline is. They taught me how to win, and more importantly, they taught me how to respond to failure, how to get back up and to keep pushing and to keep going when it just doesn't seem possible. They taught me how to be a good sport. They held me accountable for my actions. And they taught me that with a great attitude and a lot of hard work, anything is possible. Now that I'm on the other side of this equation, so to speak, I'm a parent of two young children and having coached myself many young student athletes of the next generation, I find myself even more grateful and more appreciative of the role models that I've had in my life, particularly in my high school years, which are such impressionable years of one's life. Now, as a parent and coach, I can only hope that I myself can have a similar positive impact on my children and student athletes. Thank you so much.
Next, Frank will introduce to you the 1959 swim team.
The swim team is the very first team we're inducting tonight, one of three many fine teams. They're undefeated in all their dual meets, which is really a feat in itself. First in the history, in the short history of the team. They went on to place second in the Mass State Swim and Dive Championships with less than a dozen swimmers available. They went to Brown University, got fourth place in their championships. The biggest win of the season, according to what I read, was a 51-35 defeat over eventual state champ Gardner that year. The team was coached by Mr. Robert Gross. He was also the director of the old Lone Star Rec Center, and for many people here, that was like a home away from home during the year. People hung around there all the time, playing ball, swimming, doing whatever they could do. At this time, I would like the 59 swim team to line up right here. First individual, I'm going to go by the list I have. Actually, we had about one-third of the team was able to get here today, and that was great. Okay? And we're going to start with Mr. John Ferguson.
Nice trip. See you next morning.
Help me. We have Robert Hembro. Peter Seaman. And last but not least, Mr. Robin Murphy. Also on the team, not able to get here today, was James Ferguson, Fred Flake, John Rogers, Richard McHugh, Bradford Goss, Porter Sampson, James McDonald, William DeLulio, Dirk Burnap, and Charlie Saunders. Mr. Jack Weissenau will now take the microphone in.
Thank you very much. First of all, I'd like to thank the committee for doing a great job in setting this up. This is not easy. And it looks like everything is going very well. And I'm here to basically talk about our coach. Coach Bob Gross. He was a hard, hard man. He pushed and pushed and pushed some more until he got what he wanted. And he did a great job. I personally had a lot taught to me from him. He used to tell me, take me on the weekends to tournaments, swim meets, all over New England. And at one of them that he took me to was at Yale University. And it was for the Nationals. And I said, all right. But I thought it was age group. I was 14 years old. And so I get down there, it's the total Nationals. All of the people that were gonna swim were college grads or college students from 28 different countries. The guy set a world record. Needless to say where I was. But it was a great experience. And let me hold my, check my notes here. Fancy him, so that's all right. But I'd like to thank the team because it took each and every one of us to be undefeated. That did not come easy, folks. And one time, Rich Johnson and I, we were forbidden from going up in the gymnasium. So Richie and I said, hey, it's only a foul shooting contest. Come on, let's go. So we went up, and Richie had 47 out of 50. I had 48 out of 50. And Marty Dupi, my good friend, had 49 out of 50. So that was fine until they put it in the paper. And the coach saw it. So needless to say, I think Richie and I swam 8 miles that day, each. So, but it was good. I want to thank Bobby Johnson, because Bobby and I were friends all the way up. We started at 11 years old, into the rec center, which they've already mentioned. Bobby would be there, and he would be at, have his basketball, and be coming down Merriam Avenue with his brother Eddie, into the gym. And you saw what the results are. Bobby is one of the greatest basketball players in LHS history. Now, I also want to say to all these other people that are being inducted that it wasn't easy. You worked hard to get there, just like we did. And one of the teams I have a special attachment to was the softball team. And those girls worked hard, I can tell you that, because I was there. So other than that, I want to thank everybody on behalf of the team. Also, I want to thank my family for putting up with me for 56 years to get here. Thank you.
We'd like to have Shelley come up and introduce to you Amanda Kirowak Vendi.
Thank you. Gil took one of my lines, and that is that I'm going to introduce a young lady that I've not yet had the pleasure to meet, but I do know it's this table, so hello. A little bit about the committee selection Frank alluded to earlier. About a year ago, when we started with the Matrix, we knew that we had a lifelong, journey to sort of travel to pick who ultimately would make it as the inductees. And with that, we had the boys' teams, the girls' teams, the years, and then how we wanted to spread that out, starting with the inaugural year. And as the secretary, I was writing as fast as I could. Names were flying all over the place, most of which I didn't know how to spell. Most of whom I had never met. But when it came to the swimming element, by far, unanimously, this name was spoken by almost every member of the committee. Now again, they are teachers for the most part, so they have the pleasure of seeing most of these inductees come through the ranks and understand the achievements that they've made during their time at LHS. So I only know a small portion, the portion that's in the guidelines there, the program. But most recently, we had our last meeting on Wednesday, and I think Bob made the comment that, you know, if you have the pleasure to walk in the high school and look on the wall where the records are at the individual sporting events, you would find Amanda's name in virtually every category still to this day. So the milestones that I'm about to read off to you are quite incredible in that they are still there today. So she, as was already mentioned, is a class of 1996. She was a 1993 Massachusetts State Champion in the 200-yard freestyle, 1995 Massachusetts State Champion 100-yard butterfly. And again, as we said, she holds virtually every school record as listed in the program, 200-yard freestyle, individual medley, 50-yard freestyle, 100-yard butterfly. It's just tremendous. And I can't imagine what it's like looking back at those times, but I'm sure she's going to speak to it. She also was a 1996 Academic All-American and attended Princeton. And when I tried to do some Google search so I could speak a little bit more, I also saw that she swam while she was there at Princeton University. So it is my honor to induct Amanda Kirowak-Benning into the Leominster High School Athletic Director.
I did want to just say thank you to first of all, to the committee. It's a huge honor. And also to some of the coaches that I've had in my life. My very first coach was Debbie Finch, who introduced me to swimming when I was just a preschooler at the YMCA here in Leominster. I had a great coach all growing up, that I Don Lemieux. and also my high school coach, Mr. Johnson, who was on the Leominster High School 1959 team that was just recognized. And mostly my parents. Excuse me, sorry. Being a swimmer is extremely difficult. Early morning practices. 4:30 a.m. They were the ones driving me every weekend. I'm sorry, I'm not good at this. So just thank you.
I see you briefly mentioned, I think it's worth mentioning, that at that time that Amanda was swimming, there was no pool in Leominster. And they had to go to Gardner at 4 and 5 o'clock in the morning to practice regular things. And that shows you the dedication that she had and the rest of the team that had. It's incredible. Next, I'd like to call upon Emil Johnson, who will introduce Bobby Johnson.
Oh, you're right there, okay.
Thanks for leaving the notes here, anyway. Bobby Johnson is a graduate, 1959, Leominster High School. Bobby played baseball for 2 years, was best known for his basketball play. For 3 years, he was a varsity player. Outstanding. He was the most valuable player both his junior and senior years at the high school. The team was undefeated in the regular season as a junior and lost one game as a senior. He was rated by many of the so-called experts as far as basketball playing to be the finest basketball player that ever came out of Leominster High School. After graduation from high school, he entered University of Mass, stayed there for 2 years, and then transferred to Fitchburg State. At Fitchburg State, he broke all records, averaging 39.1 points per game. Scored over 50 points 3 times in 1 season in a game. He was inducted into the Fitchburg State Hall of Fame in 1997 and the New England Basketball Hall of Fame in 2006. I'd like to present Bob Johnson.
I'm not going to use the mic. If you can't hear me, just raise your hand, please. To begin with, I would like to acknowledge Darian Saddle. He has come all the way from Maryland to join us. He is 8 years old, and he is in the third grade. He's also my grandson. So Darian, I hope you have a great time. The first part of my talk is going to be addressed to the young people in the audience. I played for Leominster High School in the late 1950s. To understand what basketball was like back then, you have to, at least, have a little knowledge of what Lumiscum was like. My guess is the population was around 25,000 people. There was no cable television. Television sets were all black and white. There were only three channels, and they would sign off the air at midnight. Radio was very important, and many high school football and basketball games were broadcast live. If a high school team had a good record, many adults would attend the games, as well as a large percentage of male and female students. If a team was on a winning streak, interest mounted, as well as attendance. There would be long lines outside the gym doors at the May A. Gallagher Junior High School on game nights. My Uncle Jack attended all the games, and I remember once he entered the gym with his head covered with snow since he had to wait in line for so long to get in. Today, high school sports have to compete against vast amounts of college and professional games that are being telecast nationally. In the late 1950s, the high school gymnasium was not regulation size. It had no seats for the public, and the ceiling was very, very low. We couldn't play a game on the court. The 1957-58 and 58-59 boys basketball teams played their home games at the Mayor Gallagher Junior High School gymnasium. To say the least, this gym was unique. Those who played on that will know that. The court was very small. Back court was the foul line extended. The backboards were made of wood, not glass. And one of the people who was supposed to, who was going to be with me tonight was Joe Bishop. And Joe was my principal in Gardner at the middle school. And Joe was the coach of Gardner High School. So he would get me every now and then and say, wow, look at that gym, I can't believe it. So Mr. Bishop he was good. Not once in those 2 years do I remember a player on our team complaining about the gym. What we wanted to do was to play basketball and to win games. In those same years, the boys' varsity teams were very good. They did not lose a home game in 2 years, and in both years won the Northwestern County Boys High School Championship. The 57-58 and 58-59 teams lost one regular season game in 2 years. I have fond memory of those two teams, particularly the year when I had the opportunity to play on the same team as my brother Ed. What impressed me most about both teams was how unselfish the players were. They never put themselves above the team. We won as a team, or we lost as a team. Sports writers refer to this as good chemistry. I know you need talent to win, but if a team has bad chemistry, it ends up losing some games that it should have won. Henry Ogier, the Leominster sports writer, commented on that very same point in one of his articles long ago. Take my word for it, it's a lot more satisfying to win than to lose. If you have any doubt about that statement, I suggest you see Emil Johnson. They will, in Emil's case, he will enlighten you very quickly. As I age, I occasionally reflect back on some people in Leominster who influenced my life in a positive way. Number one, my parents. They were fair, strict, and their love was unconditional. Number two, Dr. Wheeler. He told me that I should become a member of the Leominster Recreation Center. I joined in the fifth grade and stayed through the 12th grade. As a result, I had many positive life experiences there. Number three, Mr. Craig. He was a director of the Leominster Recreation Center for most of the 1950s. In those days, the gymnasium was closed for the summer. I think I was going into the seventh grade, and when Mr. Craig said I could play in the gym, that summer. But there was a stipulation. But if I abused that privilege once, that was it. That summer, I practiced for hours every single day, but it didn't seem like work at all. And I could think back, boy, it was fun. I enjoyed myself there. I didn't realize it at the time, but I was receiving, improving with all that practice. Last, but certainly not least, Mr. Joyce. I would call him the teacher's teacher. His advice was always positive. He emphasized to me that it's easy to set goals, but a lot of hard work is needed to achieve those goals. I cannot tell you what it means to me to be inducted into the Leominster High School Athletic Hall of Fame on the same night that Bob Cosgrove was being honored. Bob was one of the kindest, most decent people that I've ever met in my lifetime. I would like to thank my friends of many decades who are here today. I am a lucky man to have friends like you. I want to thank my son. I want to thank my son Casey and my daughter Kathleen for allowing me to be an active part in their lives. And lastly, I want to thank my former wife, Susie, for just being Susie. Casey, Kathleen, and I always knew she was the real MVP.
Thank you very much. Okay, moving along, we have next on the agenda here, Gil, would you like to come up and introduce Mike Elliott.
I wish I could introduce Mike Elliott. He is among the missing. As you have heard so many times this evening, we spent a lot of time finding people from various parts of the country, and no one has been able to help us to find Mike Elliott. If you know anything about his whereabouts, please let one of the members of the committee know. I do want to point out he was one of the finest golfers who ever played for Leominster High. Please don't take my picture unless you're going to Photoshop. So please remember, this honor goes to Mike Elliott. Thank you.
We really did everything we could to try to find Mike. I Googled it, and Facebook, and I think he's overseas. That's what I heard, possibly doing something. The last one I heard. But he was an outstanding golfer. He was a golfer over in Oosnock, and nobody there knows very. Next, we're going to have Lorraine Cipolla come up and introduce to you the 1987 state champion softball team.
Good evening. I have the honor of introducing the next team to be inducted into the Hall of Fame, the 1987 state champion girls softball team. I'd like to take the team and our guests back to that spring season. The team came together right from the start in the first practices of March. Senior captain Betty Brown provided inspiration and leadership throughout the season. The team had some great regular season wins, including those against St. Peter's, Daugherty, and Wachusett. The team was loaded with offensive threats, including the bats of Lauren Hatfield, Tracy Toll, Betty Brown, Amy Finn, and Kelly Boissonneau. Backed up by solid defense and pitching, the team finished the regular season with a 22-3 record. The girls ran through the districts, beating Daugherty for the championship, then was off to the state semifinals. A 2-1 win over Springfield Cathedral brought them to a matchup with Wellesley in the state championship game. It was a scoreless battle into the seventh. the Leominster girls came out victorious with A Steel Home by Kelly Boyson. Final score, 1-0. And as you can see by the trophy table, the team literally stole home. Ladies, for bringing Leominster its very first state title for a girls' athletic team. Thank you. We are pleased to induct the 1987 girls' softball team into the Leominster High School Athletic Hall of Fame. Come on up, ladies. Door. Is Tracy with us tonight? Come on up here, Tracy. Next, Lauren Hatfield. Brenda LeBlanc, Arsenal. Karen Williams Churi. Kelly Boissonneau Loisel. Shelly Richard. Betty Brown. Betty Brown. Lisa Hembro. Deo Giannunzio. Julie Heward Carrigan. Sally Snyder Constantine. Heather O'Malley. Yeah. Leland Woodward. Amy Finn. Amy Vaughn. And not with us tonight, Michelle DuPont. Thank you very much, ladies.
On that team, you can probably figure out I was the head coach. Also helping me with was Lynn Denning at the time, Lynn Keenan, who couldn't be, she's on the committee, and also Mr. Fran Beeling. Accepting for Mr. Beeling will be his granddaughter, Amanda.
Stealing home to win a state championship. Memories that none of us will ever forget. We had a great coach, first year coaching, second year coaching.
Both are rookies.
Kind of a rookie. We have a few memories of Frank. We won't share them here. We do want to thank the committee. I mean, they really put this all together. It's fantastic. I know they said they had 2 years, but it's really come together, and this is really great. I'd like to give them a round of applause. It's really fun to see everybody here tonight, all these girls that we went to high school with, see them with their children now. It's just great to be here and just remember all these great athletic achievements that everybody had during high school. We had a great feeding system for our team. We had the Lassie League softball that Jack Boisneau really gave us the skills to come into high school with. We already knew how to field and things like that, and we just put all the little things together. It was really kind of a magical year. We won the next year, too, so I expect we'll be back. Betty, you're the captain, you don't want to say nothing? Well, we just want to thank everybody, committee, thank all of you for coming out. It's been a great night, great memories, and it's great to see all these ladies.
Thank you, girls. By the way, you're only allowed one plaque in a lifetime or something. Forget about next year. Okay, continuing on. We'd like to bring up Kyle Baker to introduce to you Ray Arger. And if you thought Gil Trumbly was slow getting up here, you ain't seen nothing yet. This is that first chair you gotta get by, Kyle. Yes, this man was a runner.
Oh,
Yo, yo, yo. Ray Auger, all the way from Louisiana, Scott, Louisiana, I believe. pleased to have he and his wife show up, along with his brother, Wayne. I'm ad-libbing a little bit. I was privileged to coach Ray throughout his high school track and field career. His many athletic achievements are a testament to his hard work, dedication to his sport. I first met Ray when he was a junior high school, from Carter Junior High School. Ralph Case came over to track practice and asked me if I would take a look at this young athlete. Sure, what the heck. Viewing his practice throws, I knew he was a winner. And I couldn't wait until he got to the high school. Ray ended up winning two state titles in the shot put. He was also ranked 10th in the nation in 72, graduated in 72, and his record of 61 feet, 5 1/4 inches still stands as a Leominster record and did for many years in the state ranks. Please welcome Ray Auger.
Everybody, and thank Leominster High School for having the program. I want to thank my wife and my family for coming. We came here from Louisiana, and I want to thank this great opportunity to have these memories, to relive them again for one night, and thank you.
Next, Frank will introduce Ben Sanchez.
First of all, in our introductions, we did invite some dignitaries to come tonight, and one we neglected to present to you, and it's a new principal of Leominster High School, Mr. Chris Lloyd. Ben was a wrestler. Now, if you know nothing about wrestling, it's one of the most grueling sports you'll ever, ever, ever try to compete in. Many, many tough ball players have tried it and not done well at it. Ben, you'll see how he's a huge kid. He's enormous. He's about 5'4". Ben had a great career at Leominster High School. He was fourth in the D1 North Sectionals in 2002 to 2005, second in the sectional finals, 2004-05, first in the sectional championships in 2005. He was third in the Mass States in 2003 and 2005, state finalist 2004-05, Division I state champ, 05. Wow. He was Mass All-State champ, 05. Third in New England champs in 05. A great year in 05, huh, Ben? He went on to be a wrestler for the Rhode Island College team. And then he went into a bunch of other items. I'll share them with you. He was in the All-American Greco-Roman World Team. He was in U.S. Open Finals in 2012. Bronze in the Pan Am Games. Bronze in the Avo Havisto Tournament in Finland in 2012. And University World Team finalist. Well, Ben, I guess you did a little bit. All the way from Texas, I'd like to introduce to you Mr. Ben Sanchez.
First off, I want to thank the committee for putting this together. I also want to say congratulations to my fellow athletes. It's an honor to be inducted with you here tonight. There have been a lot of great athletes to go through Lumminster High School and this town alone, and I'm just privileged to be recognized tonight and use this as an opportunity to thank a lot of people. I didn't become a state champ, you know, on my own. Like you notice, everyone was up here. They were thanking a lot of different people. And one of the common things is, you know, iron sharpens iron. And it starts first and foremost with growing up in this great town. You know, it's a blue-collar city. You know, I've traveled all over the world. I've traveled all over the country. And, you know, whenever I meet people, I start here in Lumminster. You know, I try to explain the demographic, the town, and I try to include, you know, all these great people here, and I don't know everybody, but I try to include you all, you know, kind of mesh you all together and try to explain you all at once. And it's difficult to do, but I think everyone, you know, gets the gist of it when I try to explain Lumminster to them. I heard a quote that really hit home to me. It was, coincidence is God's way of remaining anonymous. True. Coincidence is God's way of remaining anonymous. True. That starts from this town, and this goes, you know, my family, my friends, my coaches, and everyone in between. Someone tonight said, you know, there were many hands in their accomplishments. You know, a lot of different people influenced them and affected them and it propelled them to get where they needed to go in life. And I truly believe I got to this point in my life because of every person that came into my life, you know, before high school and certainly through high school, because that was through wrestling I found myself, and that gave me direction to keep going and moving forward. And that propelled me to Northern Michigan, you know, and the Olympic Training Center out in Colorado Springs. And I truly believe I got that confidence, you know, from this town and my family, you know, a lot of different people. I want to give a special thank you to my family. Thank you. My cards were dealt well when it came to you guys, you know. I don't believe that was a coincidence. You all hold a special and unique place in my heart. And each one of you gave me something different, you know, a different weapon in my arsenal to just essentially attack life. And there's way too many of you here for me to thank every one of you individually, but I just want to say thank you. My coaches, and you became family faster than I picked up wrestling my freshman year, you know. Just, I wouldn't even be standing here if it wasn't for you guys either, and I just want to say thank you for that as well. My friends, man, you guys became family as well, you know? Like, some of you, you lit that competitive fire early on when I was young. You know, I brought that to Pop Warner, and I approach everything I do with that mentality. You know, you can't, you just, money can't buy that approach, you know? And everything I do, everything I touch, I approach with that mentality that I'm gonna do it to the best of my ability. Thank you. So, although I played an individual sport, I want all of you to understand, you know, some of you might be naive to wrestling. I went out there by myself, did my thing, but, you know, having the family, the community, my friends, my coaches, just the loved ones. Like, look at the love we have here today, you know. I wish there was more room to fill more people in here, because I'm sure there'd be five times the amount of people that I hit today. But it's easy to be successful when you have those type of people in your corner, no matter what you do. And I'm using this as my voice, you know, getting recognized so that way I can, this is my mountain that I'm, you know, screaming out from to thank everybody. So that means more to me than any of you guys will even know. So thank you, and I love you.
Rich Barnaby will introduce you to Henry St. Cyr.
Thank you. As the youngest member of the committee, I felt like I really had to hustle up here to make up for some lost time. Such a great night, not only for our inductees, who in a not a good sports town, but a great sports town out of hundreds of great athletes, were chosen to be the inaugural athletic class. I mean, that's such an accomplishment, but also for the city of Leominster, who deserves a Hall of Fame, who deserves to celebrate the excellence that we've shown for over 100 years. I mean, we've been playing Fitchburg at something for over 100 years, so what a great night for Leominster, and what a great night for our athletes. And our next athlete, like all our inductees, was not only successful in athletics at Leominster High School, but they were also successful after high school, after college, and in life. And I think that goes, if you're going to be an elite high school athlete, it takes discipline, it takes hard work. And if you're going to be elite and successful in life, it's going to take that same discipline and that same hard work. Henry Hank St. Cyr, he graduated in 1962. He lettered in basketball for 3 years. 1962, he was part of the North Worcester County All-Star basketball team. He also lettered in baseball for 3 years, what Coach Johnson tells me. He batted 400, was a smooth fielder, which is especially impressive because back in 1962, you could play two varsity sports in the same season, so he also lettered in track that year as well. He was a leader on the field, but he was also a leader in the classroom. He was the president of TAG, he was the yearbook editor, and like all of our inductees tonight, he went on to have a successful college athletic career, which is especially impressive. I got to meet Hank for the first time tonight, and it is really my pleasure to induct Hank St. Cyr into the Leominster Athletics Hall of Fame.
Thank you very much for being here. I thought Bob Johnson did a great job of setting the scene, if you will, for what athletics, especially basketball, was like back in the late 50s and the early 60s. And as I look at this crowd tonight, I have to tell you, I think that there are more people here tonight than there were at the Maya Gallagher gym when we played our home games. Frank said earlier this week there were 250 or so people who would be in attendance. He said to me earlier tonight it was 280. So this is a great turnout, and thanks very much for being here. I'm very honored to be here. I'm in awe of the individuals who have been inducted before me and will come after me. These are tremendous athletic achievements, and my hat's off to everyone here tonight who's being inducted. I also want to thank the Hall of Fame Committee. I think it's a wonderful undertaking. They've worked very hard. A lot of time was put into an effort like this, and it's being shown tonight in a very successful event. And things like this don't just happen. So thanks to all of the committee members who have had a hand in preparing this evening. I'm really thrilled to be here with a special person, I think, who was inducted earlier, and that's Bob Johnson. And Bob Johnson and I played many, many years ago in a variety of circles, but obviously at the high school, at the rec center, and many other venues. And I have to echo what Emil said. I think Bob was by far the greatest basketball player in LHS history. No question about it. And finally, in closing, I want to say that I want to thank all of my teammates for making me look so good on the basketball court and on the baseball diamond. Because they were the ones who made it possible for me to be here tonight to receive this great honor. So thank you very much and enjoy the rest of the evening.
Next, we have the 1978 soccer team, state champion. First time state champion of soccer. This team had a season record of 17 wins, 2 ties, 3 losses. They had a 20-game unbeaten streak. It went through the playoffs against Wachusett Regional, Worcester North, and Marlboro, which was the district championship game. And then it went down and beat New Bedford, which was unheard of. And then a game that they were predicted, there was no way in hell they were going to win. No business being there, but they defeated Wakefield for the championship, and that was the night before Thanksgiving in 1978. It was a great team led by 3 captains, and I'm going to have those of the members of that team that are here tonight, please line up over here. We can give you an individual plaque. So the 1978 soccer team, if you would line up over here, please. Some aren't here, but I'm going to read the names of everybody who's on the team anyway. Okay, I know there are some not here, but I'm going to read you the names of everybody that was on the team as we go along. First is Jeff Tall. Is he here? Okay. Rick Masterash. Come on down. Come on down. All right, we're going to hand him up. Okay. All right, I'll check the ones that were here. Okay. Yeah, Teddy. Oh yeah, then you gotta get a picture. Up there on the stage, get a picture, and then off to the side. All right, yep. Okay. Jimmy Cormier. Jimmy. Mark McQueer. One of the captains, Steve Erb. Another one of the captains, Rich Agnew. Dave Pollock. Hope I get this right. Peter Ja Nielsen. Close. All the way from Denmark. Another cat, Scott Bernier. Ted Cormier. Ted. Oh, no, that's okay. And before, and then before I give you this one, I just wanted to rename. Name the other members of the team. One here, Vince Burrell, Ray Brito, Mark Cristoforo, Randy Cormier, posthumously, Bob Eagle, Danny Frieda, Donnie LaFortune, Mark LeBlanc, Mike Maroney, George Martinez, Danny Paville, Jeff Rosciolo, David Savatelli, and Jeff Tarr. Now, in the coach, Emil Johnson. Assistant coaches were Donnie Frieda and Malcolm McPherson.
Things that this group in 1978, we did not have youth soccer in the city of Leominster yet. So they were all kids that came in as freshmen that never played the game. And we were 0-2 to start the season. And everyone was not too happy. They just asked for more work. We had a bunch of great kids. We ended the regular season at 12-2-3. We then went on to play Wachusett. We were seeded fourth out of eight teams. We beat them in sudden death overtime. That means five-minute overtimes, two sudden death overtimes, and in the second sudden death overtime, we defeated them. We then won the semifinal game in the districts. And then we played Marlboro, which was our nemesis that beat us 1-0. They have a terrific program down there. The game, again, no score. Four overtime periods, two sudden death periods. Now it had to go into shootout. The shootout, they scored first, we missed. They missed, we made. We made, they made. We made, they. It was 3-3 with one kicker left. We made the goal. And George Martinez, who was in Florida and unable to make it tonight, terrific baseball and soccer player, made a fantastic save on the fifth shot, and we were district champs. We then went on to play New Bedford. Now, New Bedford, if anyone knows, is a hotbed for soccer. Ludlow in the Western Mass, New Bedford in the Eastern Mass. They only brought 500 fans up to the game. The rest of it was not going to be no ball game. At the halftime, we scored. They scored. It was 1-1 at halftime. Just an interesting, quickly, we had to go under the bus. It was so cold at halftime to try to get warm and talk. We went under the bus and we had one of our young men, I won't tell you who it is, said, "Coach, this defense isn't working. We're going to try something else." Everyone sank in their seats while the old man raised his voice a little bit. But we went out in the second half, scored a goal, and beat New Bedford 2-1. And now we went to the state championship against Wakefield at BU Nickerson Field. Night before Thanksgiving, 20 degree weather. When I say cold, it was cold. The game was 0-0 to late in the ball game. And Teddy Cormier beat the goalie through the 5-hole, 1-0. And as Ted Dapko said, the greatest accomplishment of any sports athletic team at Leominster High School up to that point. And that was the Leominster High soccer team, 1978.
First, like everybody else who's been up here, I think we're all honored to be inducted, especially in this first group. It's quite an honor. I think we're all overwhelmed by the turnout and just the response that everybody's given to all of the athletes. Also, like to thank the committee. I've done a number of projects throughout my life, and to put something together like this in such a short period of time is absolutely amazing. And I think tonight has gone extremely well, and I give them a round of applause. I know they want to go. Coach, when we started out as freshmen, he's right, we had never played soccer, we didn't even know what a ball was, and he taught us and coached us, and it wasn't always easy. I can remember taking laps many, many times. I think we can all relate to take two. But he also taught us a lot about life and things in general. He taught us how, as other people have said about Coach, about how to win, how to lose, even though we never like to lose, but also about how to carry ourselves and how to be decent people and just present ourselves. He taught us to have pride in ourselves and what we could do. He taught us that we could do just about anything, and we proved it. He also taught us that you don't have to be fancy. It's been said here before that we were, well, a perfect example of what I'm trying to say is when we showed up for the state game at Wakefield, Wakefield came out in their color matching uniforms, their matching sweatpants, matching tops. We came out in just what we had, and we didn't care. We had the pride, and we knew we could win. It just didn't matter. It wasn't about what you looked like. It's about what you felt and what you could do. And a lot of that goes to our coach. It was cold. I think we all agree. Another thing that Coach always taught us was you just have to suck it up. And we weren't allowed to wear, we wore shorts and our shirts. We couldn't wear pants underneath, and we couldn't wear long sleeve shirts. You just had to suck it up and play. And I think that might have been an intimidation factor, and it certainly worked. It also made you run more when you were cold. And it's just, it's an honor to be here with everybody. It's good to see everybody. It's a great turnout. And again, I'd just like to thank everyone. It's quite an honor.
Okay, congratulations. Next, Shelley Berry will introduce to you Bruce Willard.
All right. Once again, I'm back to the pool. I'm another swimmer. But this time, the list is a bit longer as far as accomplishments. But Bruce Willard was a graduate of the class of 1969. He did have several records. In 67, 68, and 69, which I'll go over. But when researching him, I found that his accomplishments had happened, or started, I should say, before he reached high school, as I learned about his achievements on the Stingrays, and can't imagine the amount of hours he spent in the pool through those years, through high school, and then as he moved on to attend the University of Vermont, and then further winning more championships and records while attending UVM. But while at Leominster High School, he did win the New England Championship in 1967 in the 400 freestyle. Again, he won the 100-yard freestyle in 68. And he won both the 50 and the 100 in 1969 at the New England Championships. As I read his biography, I found that he further went on to become an educator and bring up probably the next generation of young swimmers, which I'm sure he'll talk about. In 1987, he was inducted into the University of Vermont Hall of Fame, so this just adds to his repertoire of Hall of Fame inductions. So it is my pleasure to introduce Bruce Willard as an inductee into the Leominster High School Hall of Fame.
Championship relay teams, that's four people, swimming, and also 24 state champions. Quite a job, Coach Richard Johnson.
Now it is my pleasure and honor to introduce to you Ms. Pat Parthia. I don't think I have to introduce her yet, we all know her, but some of the things you may not know. Pat taught physical education for 20 years, was a guidance counselor for 24 years. 44 years in the school system. Does anybody do that anymore? I don't think so. Not in the current situation. She was a pioneer in women's sports, was among the first female teachers at Leominster High School to grant a leave of absence. When she first started teaching PE in 1951, it was expected she would coach. Unlike her male counterparts, women received no salary. That would not change for another decade. She coached three sports, field hockey, basketball, softball. Funding was minimal and students would hold bake sales to purchase uniforms. In the early years, it was common to have 70 girls on a roster. She always put the kids first over a win. But despite that, her field hockey teams rarely missed a postseason competition. And in the 70s and the 80s, the softball teams went to the districts 8 out of 10 years. Her softball team recorded 215 wins and 103 losses. Throughout most of her career, she was a star or an advisor at the LHS for a national organization named GAA. Athletes are always treated as individuals with her, as the standard of good sportsmanship was always the rule. Because she never liked being called coach, her name was always Lady. Her caring ways and dedication to the girls is evident. 63 years later, people in the community still call out, "Hey Lady," when they see her. recalling their time spent with her as a teacher, coach, or counselor. This GAA club fostered friendship and participated in many school events, all for the advancement of women in sports. The coveted White Blazer Award was given to female athletes who participated in four varsity sports by the senior year. This was a gold achievement and was voted on by the girls' peers. She ran this organization for 27 years. After retiring from coaching in the mid-80s, she went on to excel in her position as guidance counselor. She was honored as Massachusetts Counselor of the Year in 1986, inducted into the Mass Softball Hall of Fame in 1994, and recognized by the City of Leominster as the Citizen of the Year in 1995. Lady was inducted into the New Agenda Northeast Hall of Fame for Women's Sports. In addition to her role as a counselor, she organized the Senior Awards Night for numerous years. She was also one of the five founders of the LHS Alumni Scholarship Fund and the executive chairperson for that fund for many years, as well as serving on the Leominster Recreation Commission for many years. After she retired from LHS, she jumped right back into teaching. She became involved in an adult literacy program. She taught an adult woman not only to read, but to study and become a U.S. citizen. Today, life is less complex. She has enjoyed traveling to 49 United States states and over 50 countries in six continents. Her life with her husband, Ray, who she's been married to for 63 years, is content and easy. He has been the biggest supporter. And because of her close friendship with Paul and Ciccone and her family and grandchildren, she has lived a life that many could only dream of, one full of love and pride. And that's what we feel tonight.
God bless you all.
Now, Laureen Spoller will introduce to you Carl Baker. Better start now, Carl. Let's go.
Me to introduce our next inductee, Carl Baker, class of 1954, was a standout track athlete during his high school career. Carl was undefeated in every mile event he ran during regular season meets throughout high school. In both his junior and senior year, Carl placed in the top five runners in the mile event at the state track meets. In his senior year, he was the captain of the track team and awarded Most Valuable Player. Carl furthered his education at the University of Massachusetts and Fitchburg State College. He returned to Leominster School System as a teacher of social studies and ended his career over 31 years as department head for the social studies department at LHS. As a dedicated coach for more than 30 years at Leominster High School, Carl promoted and guided many athletes and teams to success. He was the coach for the first boys cross country team, first girls track team, and the first indoor track team. Carl coached state champions in the mile, men's and women's shot put, and women's javelin. Carl's family includes wife Margaret Morgan, children Carolyn, Karen, Mark, Jennifer, and Angelina, many of whom are here to share in his honor. Kyle continues to promote and support both educational and athletic initiatives here in Leominster, including, again, the Alumni Scholarship Fund, which has provided Leominster graduates with over $300,000 in scholarships. Again, it is our pleasure to induct Kyle Baker into the Leominster High School Athletic Hall of Fame.
Career as a runner and coach, I've met many inspiring individuals that have meant so much to me through the years. Too many to mention, but I would be remiss not to name a few, including Mark Cleaves, Charlie Broderick, Leon Huck Hannigan, fellow inductees Pat Parthia, Ted Damko, Ralph Case, Charles Sadaika, Trish Nicholson, Noreen McLaughlin, Karen Marino, and Pete Bollier. I'd also like to thank my family for their continued love and support, many of whom are here with me tonight, two tables worth. Yay! Throughout the years, there were many exciting and funny events. For example, the girls' track team never failed to surprise me. Once, at the beginning of practice, they were nowhere to be found. It was standard procedure to do a warm-up run. And I went out to the field looking around for the team. They were not around. As I looked around for them, they started falling out of the trees, lined up Pre-Street. A few days later, the same rascals found it amusing to pile into my Porsche. deviating a little bit, I wanted to highlight, as was just done, the Leominster High School Alumni Scholarship Fund. Again, which is, to date, has over $400,000 given in scholarships to LHS seniors. As we continue and increase the number of scholarships bestowed each year, and encourage you guys out there to this worthy endeavor. It's one of the hallmarks that I treasure almost most. According to this, I don't have any other nets left. Thanks. Thank you very much for this award.
Yeah.
Okay. Where's Barnaby? Yeah, you're gonna get old
someday. Once again, it is my honor and pleasure to introduce this next inductee, Ted Damko, who is a close personal friend of mine and somewhat of a mentor in many ways as far as coaching and in athletics. Ted graduated from South High School in Worcester in 1947, where he played varsity basketball and football. After serving in the Army during the Korean War, he received a bachelor's degree and master's degree in physical education from Boston University, where he also played varsity football. Then Ted joined the staff of Leominster High School and was a member of the staff for 39 years, retiring in 1992. He was the athletic director for more than 20 of those years. As a member and past president of the Massachusetts Secondary School Athletic Directors Association, and he was chairman of the State Retired Athletic Directors Association. He was a member of the State Basketball and State Football Coaches Association, a charter member of the Central Massachusetts Chapter of the National Football Foundation, and the Hall of Fame. He assigned all officials to Central Mass District basketball tournaments, was a member of the Central Mass Football Tournament Committee. He was awarded the Central Massachusetts Athletic Director of the Year in 1985 and 1986. And he was awarded the National Interscholastic Athletic Administrator's State Award of Merit in 1996. And the Central Division Football MVP Award is named after Ted Damko. I think the best way to sum up was in 1992, the class of 92 dedicated their yearbook to Ted Damko. And I'd like to kind of read a little bit of what it says. When the class of 1992 graduates, it would leave with a lot of fond memories of academic, athletic, and achievements. Athletes, especially, have been a major factor in the development of the Leominster student. For the past 18 years, there's been one man in particular who was always there to help the Leominster athlete excel, Ted Damko. We'll always remember him as our athletic director. In his memorable career, he also has been a successful football and he was a varsity basketball coach from 1964 to 1975. He has overseen a high school sports program with 6 state championships in various sports and 7 Super Bowl appearances under its belt. While other communities dropped many of their sport teams due to Proposition 2.5 and the years of recession, he fought to keep ours alive. He serves on the Massachusetts Scholastic Athletic Association and is the respected president of Massachusetts Athletic Directors. Leominster High has seen students and teachers come and go, but Ted Damko is anything but another departing faculty member. He has and always will be the friend and contributor to Leominster sports. And so we wish him farewell and his gratitude dedicate this yearbook to him. On that page, there were also a few quotes from some of the coaches. Just a couple of them. One coach was Emil Johnson said, "The major reason why Leominster High School athletics here have been so successful has been Ted Damko's loyalty and dedication to the student athlete. Academics have always been high on his priorities. Besides being my boss, he's always been a very loyal and trusted friend." Coach Dabzinski said, "Coach Damko is characterized by his dedication to LHS and its students and the programs. He's been a friend and a loyal faculty member to thousands of kids that have come through here." And I guess I was quoted as saying, "His number one thought has always been the kids. His main philosophy is that athletics is there for the kids. Athletics is a privilege, not a right." And he was all for Leominster High School, and he loved Leominster High School. And it's my honor to present this award to his niece, Johanna Basilis. Basilis, right? You're right, Basilis.
all on behalf of my uncle. He would be so happy and humbled that you remember him in such a meaningful way. Thank you.
Now, Ms. Barnaby will introduce to you Jane Roman Bergeron.
Slow down, Barnaby. Slow down.
All right, thank you. I do have to commend the efficiency of this presentation tonight. When I founded the Baseball Hall of Fame a few years ago, the presentations were well over 4 hours, mostly because of emo. But tonight we're getting through this much quicker. And the Baseball Hall of Fame has been absorbed into this one as well. I have a 10-year-old daughter who plays sports in Leominster. She plays four sports. She plays all year round on the best fields and the best coaches, and has all the opportunity in the world. And I feel like if it wasn't for the inductees tonight, people like Pat Pothia, Danielle, Amanda, and our next inductee, Jane Gorham Bergeron, my daughter might not have those opportunities. Jane Gorham Bergeron, who not only excelled at sports in high school and college, but gave back to the community as a teacher, coach, and referee well after her playing days were done. Jane graduated in 1969 as the first female athlete to letter in four sports, 4 years of field hockey, 4 years of basketball, 4 years of softball, and 2 years of tennis. Jane holds the record for the highest points scored in a basketball game at 35, where she commonly showed off her famous hook shot, which was featured on WEIM radio. She received the Mount Wachusett Golden Glove Award for softball, was named the most athletic senior girl by her peers. Jane was also a leader outside of athletics, where she received the White Blazer Award, was president of the Girls Athletic Association. It's my pleasure to introduce Jane Gorham Bergeron as the athletic Hall of Fame.
Say other than I really have to thank my coaches way back when. Some of you know Mrs. Spadaro, and there was Mrs. Buckley. I went right up the line, but Lady was the one that changed the world for women's sports. And we never even had gym uniforms. She was that great that she made sure we had gym uniforms. But when you play sports, you do it because you love it. My biggest thing was playing and competing. I laughed because I played racquetball with Richard, right? Richard? I played ping pong against Mr. Baker because he challenged me 3 games and I beat him. I love playing sports, and that's what I'm trying, that's all I'm gonna say. Anybody that knows me knows I love sports, and I do it because, but to be recognized, when they called me and told me that someone had put my name in, to me it was like I said to my friend, I said, teachers, we changed the world. But I said, when I was told that I was an inductee into the Hall of Fame, I felt like I won the Olympics. Are you kidding me? To me, this is the biggest honor in my lifetime, and I will treasure this forever. Thank you. Have a good night.
We're going to have Frank, who's going to close the program out, but before he does that, Bobby Sabatelli, you owe me breakfast. He said, if you get this thing done inside of 3 hours, I'll buy breakfast for you. Well, the ceremony is only 2 hours, so we're doing all right. Here's Frank to close out the program.
We're going for another hour. Bobby, buy me a breakfast. First of all, Hank and Bobby spoke about basketball and Gallagher. For you people who don't know Gallagher, it's a swimming pool with a basketball court painted onto it. So when you ran into it, you literally ran into the walls. Okay? And the high school was even worse because the ceiling was about that high. So you had not many choices, but they did a great job when they played, I'll tell you. But truthfully, us as a committee thoroughly have enjoyed hosting all you people today. It's gone way beyond what we thought it was going to be. We never thought we'd go past those posts right there. Now we're back to the bar. In fact, I think some people are tending bar back there while they're working. I'm really honored to be on this committee with all these guys and girls. And I wish you all a great year. And don't be strangers, because we'll be back in next year. You want to help us out? Let me know. We can always lose some help. Okay? And Bob's going to mention something else. Here goes that owl, Bobby.
I just want to remind everybody that if you want pictures of this evening, go on to Rich Marchand Blue Devil Photos. And the pictures that were taken. And afterwards, if you want a picture of with your family and your plaque and everything, we're going to move this podium and this table here, and you can stand right up here, and Rick will take your picture for that as well. If anybody, we are filming it tonight. If you want would like a copy of it, after I get the DVD copy, you can email me, and I'll make a copy for you. I have a machine that can do that. It's R.L. Healy at Comcast.net. If you want to write that down. We'll put that on the website as well. All right? And you can get your furniture a copy of the video. Okay? So, if anybody can do it.
I wish you all a good night and enjoy the rest of the week.